Thank you very much. Today's the first presentation we're doing today is the Windows Azure Overview. My name is Randy Patterson. I work for Catapult Systems. My Twitter handle is CodeToLive. Feel free to subscribe or follow my Twitter. First thing I want to talk about is the Windows environment, especially Visual Studio. If we take a look at what Visual Studio offers today, we have the ability to write applications for our laptop, for tablets, even for Windows Phone, or any phone really, iOS and other phone environments. And embedded, we can also write applications for various front ends, including embedded, like the Microsoft Sync and cars and automobiles, as well as games for the Xbox. In addition to the front end, we also can write applications that deal with various backends, all the way from single server and on-premise single server to enterprise applications on-premise, and also write for the backend. We can now write applications for the cloud, which allows us to scale from shared servers in a single data center to hundreds or thousands of servers spread out across the globe, all within the Windows environment and all within Visual Studio. So what is the cloud? The industry has a couple of terms for cloud, including the cloud, cloud computing, and cloud devices. What Microsoft looks at when they see the cloud, what they think of the cloud as being giving you the ability to deploy your applications and scale infinitely across the globe or even in a single data center close to your users. Windows Azure is flexible, open, and solid, and we'll cover all three of these aspects, not only in this presentation, but in other presentations throughout the day today. But we'll see how flexible Windows Azure is. We'll look at the open standards, and we'll talk a bit about what standards are available and how they're open sourced, and other vendors can use them as well to communicate with Windows Azure. I mean, how solid it is. We'll discuss some of the fault tolerance and reliability of Windows Azure, not only in this presentation, but in other ones as well. The industry has three categories that it puts cloud computing in, including infrastructure as a service, or IaaS, platform as a service, or PaaS, and software as a service, or SaaS. Now, Windows Azure has three aspects that it uses to categorize your development into those three industry standards. Virtual machines are used for the infrastructure as a service, and these are spinning up your own servers, your own virtual machines inside of the cloud, anywhere in any of the data centers across the globe. Cloud services, worker roles, and web roles are used for the platform as a service. This allows you to develop your applications very quickly, not worry so much about the infrastructure behind it. And software as a service, websites are used to categorize their software as a service. Now, that's the very simple, very easy way to get your applications, your web applications, up and running in the cloud. Now, you don't have to pick one or the other. With the Windows Azure, you can choose to mix and match. So, for example, we can spin up a SQL Server in the cloud as a virtual machine, or BizTalk, or any of the other servers, and also Linux. We can do a Linux server as well. In addition, we can create a couple of worker or web roles as a cloud service, and then we can have our websites talk directly, for example, to our SQL Server in the cloud. We can, in fact, in our first demo, our first lab, we'll show you how to set up a SQL Server VM and have a website that communicates directly with that. But in addition, your websites could also communicate with a worker role, and the worker role could talk to BizTalk, and BizTalk could talk to SQL Server, and so on and so forth. You can mix and match these different services. You don't have to stick with just one or the other. That's one of the beauties of Windows Azure and cloud computing. So let's talk a little bit about on-premise and what you are responsible for. Compare that to what's available in the cloud. So with on-premise software, it is your responsibility to make sure that the networking stack is up and running and ready to go, that the storage mechanisms, either spinning platters or SSD, that's your responsibility to figure that out, what is best for your application, as well as the OS. You have to make sure that the OS is patched and that it's updated for security reasons. And it's your responsibility then as well to make sure to write your data, to create your data, make sure that it's backed up, and that your data is also fault tolerant, and to write and maintain your application. So the entire stack is yours from cradle to grave. So you are in control and you manage the entire stack for on-premise applications. With cloud computing, the green boxes represent what's managed by the data center, and the orange represents what you manage. And with this, we get less flexibility. The more that's managed by the data center, the less flexible, the fewer options that we have. So for example, with virtual machines, it is our responsibility to make sure that the OS is updated and patched. But then everything else, the virtualization, the network, the storage, all that's managed by the data center. You don't have to worry about that. And it's also your responsibility to make sure that you know, the applications are written properly and your data is backed up and clustered for high availability. For platform as a service, when we're dealing with worker roles and web roles, our management, our responsibility is lessened. So now we have, our responsibility just focuses on our data and our applications. Everything else is managed by the data center or managed by Windows Azure. For software as a service, some examples of software as a service include things like Office 365, Gmail, if I can spell that right, some of the other third-party vendors like Salesforce.com. Those are examples of software as a service where it's your responsibility to maintain your password and user ID. The application or the vendor has a responsibility of maintaining everything else in that stack. The Windows Azure data centers, right now we have, or Windows Azure has data centers throughout the globe, including four here in the US and spread out through the country. And they also have announced that they're opening up data centers in China, in Australia, and Japan. And Microsoft, or Windows Azure, is the first vendor to open up data centers in China. And the green dots represent the CDNs, or the content delivery networks. Those are the networks that allow you to cache your data so that it's as close to the user as possible. And this is just a small sampling. There are dozens more throughout the globe. And don't forget, if you currently don't have a Windows Azure account, or you don't want to use your current account for these labs today, go ahead and sign up for the, using this URL, sign up for the trial, the Windows Azure trial. This will give you $200 of credit or 30 days, whichever comes first. So make sure that when you sign up for this account, this free trial, go ahead and use all $200. You know, spin up your VMs, try some of the more expensive aspects of Azure, you know, spin up some SQL servers, give those a try. The important thing is after 30 days or $200, your account is canceled. You will be asked for a credit card, but that is just to make sure that you're a human and to make sure that you're over 18 years old. Your credit card will not be charged. So it's 30 days or $200, whichever comes first, and you know it's gone at that point. Your credit card would not be charged. So how many people here in the audience do not currently have a Windows Azure account or have never seen the Windows Azure portal? Okay, so we have quite a few. So make sure that you sign up for that free trial so that we can do our labs today. So I'm going to quickly go over the Windows portal. So here, once you sign up, you just go to the WindowsAzure.com and you're presented with this free trial. Go ahead and click on that. You do need a credit card, but again, you will not be charged. So when you first get into the Windows Azure portal, you're presented with everything that you currently have running. For example, I have a couple of websites and some app services, some cloud services. But over here on the left is all of the different aspects or different areas that you can filter your portal for. So for example, I can look and see my virtual machines, take a look and see what's going on with those. I can look at my websites. You can see that most of mine are in the East Data Center. I'm running in free mode. You can look at storage, HD Insight, that's the Hadoop clusters. If you need to process large amounts of data. Media services, we've got all kinds of different aspects here in Windows Azure. And down in the bottom is our, very similar to Windows 8, that's our charms bar. This will give us additional information for whatever it is that we're looking at on the site. So for example, if I go to websites, my charms on the bottom changed, or my menu on the bottom here changes to focus just on the website. So from here, I can browse the website, I can stop it, I can restart it. In addition to that, if I go and create something new, let me just do a quick website. You can see I have some notifications down here that show up. And that lets me know that every time I make a change or I add something new, this is giving me some feedback as to what's going on. As soon as it's finished, you can see that I have a, it tells me down here in the charm section that I have, whatever it is I just did is finished and completed successfully. Right, and subscriptions are a unit of billing. So it doesn't matter whether you're using 500 CPUs in one project or, for example, 50 CPUs in 10 projects, you're still charged for the same amount for 500 CPUs. So think of each subscription that you have as a unit of billing. It doesn't matter how the resources are being used or how they're clustered together. The billing is all the same. And you can also think of, since it's a unit of billing, you can think of using your subscriptions, having one for QA, one for developers, and certainly one for production. Now, I've seen a lot of companies that will spread it out like this so that they can keep track of what resources are being used for QA and development, and also have a different subscription, for example, for production, so they can keep track of what's going on in production and how much they're being charged on a monthly basis. And some clients will actually keep it all in one, but that it makes it very difficult at that point to track and see who's using what and what's going on. Now, we've talked a little bit about the IaaS, the infrastructure, the virtual machines. We've talked a little bit about cloud services, and we've talked a bit about websites. But there's a fourth aspect of Windows Azure called mobile services. And this is a section of Windows Azure that allows you to take your mobile devices, whether they're tablets or smartphones, and allow them to connect directly to your cloud services and easy access to your data through mobile services. And go ahead, either on your free account or on your normal Windows Azure account, go ahead and take a look at these mobile services, because there is a free tier that gives you, I think it's a 20 megabyte SQL server for the back end, as well as 500 devices and several thousand transactions per month. It's a pretty robust free tier to give you an idea of what's going on and how to use those mobile services. So go ahead and give it a try. If you do publish a store to the app, I mean an app to the store, you can. That free tier is enough to get you going. So it's a really nice option for you. Now, SQL database. This is a managed SQL database in the cloud. It's a relational SQL Server engine managed by the data center or managed by Microsoft. This is not running on a virtual machine. This is managed by Microsoft as a service to you. So it gives you most of the aspects of an on-premise SQL Server, including triggers and stored procedures. The advantage of the managed side of it is that Microsoft will manage the clustering for you. So you ask, for example, you ask for a 10 gig database, you actually get three of them in the same data center clustered together. And all that, you don't notice that, it's just a connection string for you. Microsoft or Windows Azure will manage that clustering for you. It's still your responsibility to do the backups. But with the managed services, you do get the clustering included with that, as well as the redundancy of three copies of your data. I'm sorry?
What does that entail?
Well, Microsoft will take care of setting up three databases for you and then cluster those together. You no longer have to manage all of that. But, yes? Yeah, there are several services and options for backing up your SQL database in the cloud, but it is your responsibility to make sure that it's backed up, because even though you are protected pretty well from hardware failures or software failures, there are still some issues, a bug in the program or some corruption of data from your application. So you do need to make sure that you have a backup. So there's a Microsoft Data Sync and a few other options you have for backing up your data. You can pull it, either back it up to storage, another storage mechanism, or you can pull it locally. But it is, I'm sorry, I can't hear. No, the Windows Azure will take care of patching the OS and patching SQL Server and keeping that up to date. So the question is, does the end user have to design your database? Yes, you have full access to the schema as you would a normal on-premise SQL Server. So it is your responsibility to maintain the schema as well. Sure, one more question. Just a few, yes. So the reporting services are available. SSIS, I'm not sure about that. I haven't dealt with SSIS on the SQL Server. There are a few limitations with the managed SQL Server, including things like full-text searching. But if it doesn't meet your needs, you can always install SQL Server in a virtual machine and have it that way. But I'm not sure about SSIS. I'll have to look into that. So caching. In addition to other services that are provided with Windows Azure, we have to have the ability to have a distributed cache, because when you're dealing with a clustered set of websites, you know, when you have just one IIS server running, caching is not as big of a deal, or distributed cache. But when you have 10 or 15 websites running, you have to make sure that not only your session state, but also your caching is distributed between all of your instances of SQL Server. And this is what the caching service will do for you. It will take, it's an in-memory, low-latency cache. It will take, there's two options for this, but the main one option is to take your web roles or your websites and allocate some portion of the memory for cache. So for example, here I have four web roles running. Each of those have 300 meg reserved for my cache. And combined together, I have 1.2 gigabyte of distributed cache. So when one role caches some data, the other three roles will have access to that same data through the cache. All under, I think it's a 1 millisecond latency. So even though that in this case it's part of the service, part of the web role, that we can set up this cache, but even though one role cached some data, all my roles will have access to that same cache data. It doesn't matter what it is. In addition, if I go to the portal and I need to increase this to 10 roles, the same thing will happen. Those 10 roles will spin up, 300 meg in each role will be allocated towards cache, and then they'll all be linked together. The other option we have is to dedicate an entire worker role as a cache worker role. So all of its memory then is allocated as a distributed cache. Then we can go in and we can not only have one role, but we can increase that number of roles to two. For example, in this case, I have a worker role that has 12 gigabyte of memory, all of which is dedicated as a distributed cache. With two roles, now I have 24. I can go to the portal, I can update that to four. Now I have 48 gigabyte of cache to use as with my web roles. And the code stays the same. It doesn't matter if it's a worker role or shared with my web role. The caching code remains the same. Identity. So most of our enterprise applications have Active Directory or use Active Directory for identity management. You can set up Windows Azure so that the Active Directory is shared not only with your on-premise Active Directory, so that your applications in the cloud will have access to your users and their credentials, but you can also set it up so that your clients can also share their Active Directory to your application. So it's single sign-on for your clients or your partners so that they can have access to your application with a single sign-on. They log into the Windows machine, and those credentials are being used by your application through Active Directory. The service bus is another mechanism, another way of communicating with your on-premise apps. So what the service bus does is it allows your applications to communicate behind a firewall to an on-premise data or services behind your corporate firewall. So in this example, we have a tablet that needs to connect to our application, but we have some data that's sitting behind a firewall on-premise. So our application will go ahead and connect to our cloud service, our website, or our cloud service. That message can be relayed then securely, relayed to our on-premise database or services behind our corporate firewall. So the communication can happen with any of our cloud devices, whether they're tablets, phones, or laptops, and securely relayed to our on-premise data or on-premise services. So this just gives us another way of communicating or writing our applications in the cloud. So the Windows Azure Store, this is growing all the time. Let me go ahead and open this up in the browser. So let me go back to my... So if we scroll down to add-ons, we can get access now to the Windows Store. So these are the services that I've subscribed to from the Windows Store. So I'll click on New, and I'll click on the Store, which is currently in preview. And this is growing. This list of applications are growing all the time. These are third-party add-ons for Windows Azure. And we have access to things like authentication. We can do this Melissa data is an address verification check. So we can send our address to Melissa. And it'll verify that the address is correct. And there are most of these have free services, so go ahead and check it. For example, for free, we can do 1,000 checks per month for addresses, and that's pretty outstanding. But in addition to that, we have, you know, if I scroll through these, you can see all kinds of different value adds that we can put in into our Windows Azure. So Here's an automatic backup. So here's a service that we can subscribe to. For free, we can have 10 backups or 50 megabyte storage. This will back up our websites for us. So we just subscribe to this, and we don't have to worry about the code in our websites. It'll back up for us automatically. There's just all kinds of different third-party services. New Relic is a nice one. This one, I believe, has a free tier for monitoring our websites. Yeah, there's a free standard version. Alert us if there's any issues with our websites. SendGrid, if your application needs to send emails out to your users for whatever reason, and with SendGrid you get 25,000 emails per month that you can send from your Windows Azure application through SendGrid. And if you need more than that, you can sign up for certain services or certain tiers on that. Very good. So just scroll through this, take a look and see what's going on. This changes all the time, so come back to this and look and see what's available for our Windows Store. All right, so the Windows Store. So in addition to those building blocks that I showed you, I think we covered most of these building blocks. On Windows Azure, there are dozens more. And make sure that you download the Windows Azure training kit, because that training kit has 50, 60 labs in there, and it'll cover all of these different aspects of Windows Azure, but many more. There are labs for pretty much anything you want to do in Windows Azure. There's a good lab to walk you through the steps of getting it set up. So make sure not only that you get the labs that you need for today's presentations and labs, but also make sure that you look through that list of 50 or 60 labs that are available to use, and you can do those later. In addition, you know, this is multiple languages, not just Visual Studio, it's not just Microsoft technologies. You can use not only .NET, but you can use Node.js, and it's very easy to set up. There's templates for websites to quickly spin up a Node.js server. You can also use Java, Python, Ruby, PHP. All those languages are available and fully supported inside of Windows Azure, websites, web services. So use the language that you're most comfortable with. Open source. Much of Windows Azure is open source, including all the labs. The SDK, if you go to GitHub here, You can see the SDK is open source. You can download a source code and take a look at it if you so choose, or modify it. But just keep in mind that the Azure SDK, most of its wrappers around the REST API. It's all open source. You can see what's going on behind the scenes if you want to. Now, questions and answers. Let's go ahead and hold off on the Q&A section for a little bit later. We'll definitely answer your questions. Thank you very much.